In this video, I'll be conducting paired or dependent sample t tests. It is also known as related sample t tests, match pair t test, or correlated sample t test. It is used to determine if a significant difference exists between two sets of measurements when those measurements are paired or related. The most common paired t test design is the repeated measures t test, or what is also called within subject t test. The repeated measure t-test is commonly used to examine the effect of a treatment or intervention on the same set of individuals, where measurements are taken twice for every individual in that sample. A common example is when measurements are taken before and after an intervention. For example, it could be used to determine if there is a statistically significant difference between starting salaries and current salaries of employees in a company. The main advantage of the repeated measures t-test is that it requires a smaller sample size compared to the independent t-test. Another paired t-test design is the matched subjects design, where each individual in one group is matched based on some common attributes of interest with an individual in the other group. Note that matched subject designs requires twice as many individuals as the corresponding repeated measures t-test. Let's now examine a repeated measures example. Here we have scores before and after some treatment. We want to determine if a significant difference exists between the before and after scores. This requires a paired samples t-test because each pair of scores belongs to one subject. We will be applying this test statistic. D bar here is the sample mean of the before and after differences. Mu D is the population mean of the differences. And in the denominator, we have the standard error of the mean of the differences. That is the standard deviation of the differences divided by the square root of the number of pairs or differences. The test requires that the distribution of the differences be approximately normal. We begin by taking the difference between each pair of scores. I'm going to do after minus before for the differences. Although it does not really matter for two-tailed test, whether we do after minus before or before minus after. However, in one-tailed tests, doing after minus before is recommended because it makes the hypothesis setup easier to understand. The sum of the differences here is 14, and the number of differences is 6. Therefore, the mean of the sample differences is 2.333. Next, we can calculate the standard deviation using this formula. We need the sum of squares of the differences, which adds up to 86. The standard deviation is thus 3.266. We can also use this formula to calculate the standard deviation by first calculating the deviations from the mean, then summing the squared deviations, which results in the same standard deviation as obtained before. Now, to test if there is a significant difference in the before and after scores, the null hypothesis would be that there is no difference, that is, the population mean difference is equal to zero. And the alternative hypothesis would be that the mean difference is not equal to zero because testing for a difference suggests we are conducting a two-tailed test. Here again is the test statistic. The denominator here is the standard error of the mean of the differences, which computes to 1.333. Mu d here is equal to zero as seen in the null hypothesis. Thus, t is essentially equal to d bar divided by the standard error, which gives 1.750. Now, suppose we're testing at the significance level alpha of 0.05. We can find the critical or rejection region using software or from the table. The degrees of freedom for the test is ND-1, which gives 5. For alpha equals 0.05 in two tails or 0.025 in one tail, the critical value is 2.571. That is, we reject the null hypothesis if the observed t is less than negative 2.571 or if it is greater than positive 2.571. Since the observed test statistic is not in the rejection region, we cannot reject the null hypothesis at alpha equals 0.05. Using software, we also find the p-value to be 0.141, which is greater than our significance level alpha of 0.05. As a result, we fail to reject the null hypothesis. Consequently, we have insufficient evidence to conclude that a significant difference exists between the before and after scores. Now, suppose the observed t-statistic is -2.750, which falls in the rejection region. We will reject the null hypothesis and conclude that a significant difference exists between the before and after scores. To construct a 95% confidence interval for the mean difference, we use this formula. For 95% confidence, alpha is 0.05, and at df equals 6 minus 1 equals 5, the critical value is 2.571, as we saw earlier. Now, substituting the values, we have a margin of error of 3.427, a lower limit of -1.9, and an upper limit of 5.76. We can also use this interval to make a decision about rejecting the null hypothesis. Since the confidence interval contains the hypothesized value 0, we fail to reject the null hypothesis at alpha equals 0.05. If this -1.9 had been positive, then the interval would not contain 0, and we will reject the null hypothesis. To interpret, we say we are 95% confident that the difference between the before and after scores lies between the lower and upper limits. And that's it for this video. Thanks for watching.